So it's me, Nicolette Mashile, and today I have got another episode of Nicolette Save My Finances. And today we're talking about the difference between bond insurance versus life insurance on your home loan. Now remember that none of my videos constitute as financial advice. If you are looking for financial advice, please speak to somebody who is certified and registered with the FSCA. So 2016, I had just applied for a home loan. My house was 3.8 million rand. I needed a home loan of 2.2 because I was going to put the difference down as a deposit, right? So everything went really well. It was, you know, the bank was quite excited that I had a deposit, and I paid the initiation fee, I paid the bond registration fee, I paid the transfer cost, I paid literally everything that I thought I needed to pay. And then also I got an insurance quote on the building of the house. So basically, if something has happened to the house, I got an insurance from the bank. Then there was one more thing that I didn't think about that was left. And the first thing they asked me is, do you have a life insurance? And I was like, well, I kind of do have a life insurance. They asked me how much is it. I said, my life insurance is worth, I think, 537,000 rand. And they're like, okay, you've got a bond of 2.2 million rand. So you're going to need to get some sort of insurance cover over the bond for in case something happens to you. I was like, hold up. What do you mean? They were like, okay, look at it this way. If you are unable to pay and service the bond, what will happen to the house? Do you want it to get repossessed and sold on the market, and then the difference is given to you, or you got to pay the difference? Or do you want that property to stay in your family and stay in your possession for as long as you can possibly keep it, and for post, you know, the bond being paid off and settled off? And I was like, of course. If something were to happen to me, whether it's permanent disability, whether I get retrenched from my job, or whether I die, I still want the property to be kept. You know, my family must be able to keep it. But what happens if your family cannot service the bond repayments? It means that then the bank is going to repossess the house and they're going to sell it, right? But if you do have a what is called a bond insurance, or what is called an MPI, a mortgage payment, mortgage policy insurance, they're called by different names, you can then get that insurance product to pay out if something has happened to you in instances where you no longer can service the debt, right? That's basically what this insurance product is. And it's important for me to keep calling it an insurance product, because a lot of people think that they're going to get their money back after they've paid this bond, after they've settled their home loan. No, you're not going to get your money back, because it did not have a surrender value, or it didn't have a component of it being an investment or a savings part of it. Remember that an insurance product is an insurance product, guys. An insurance guarantees you against an insurable event. So for instance, when it comes to your bond insurance, what is called an insurable event is if you die, if you become permanently disabled, if you are unable to work, means that your bond insurance is going to kick in and is going to pay for you while you are unable to service those kind of bond payments every single month. That's basically what it is. Now, throw in the mix a life insurance policy. So how then does a life insurance policy help you? Basically, what happens is that a life insurance will do a similar job as the bond insurance, right? So if something is to happen to you, an insurable event happens to you, you die, you get disabled, or you get retrenched, your life insurance will pay out to settle the bond or to pay off the bond while you are unable to actually service that debt. The only difference between the two is basically the type of policies or the type of product they are. Let's start off with the bond insurance. A bond insurance basically covers only the bond, right? So you take out a bond, right, with a bank. For instance, like me, the 2.2 million, you take out that bond. You then need to get a bond insurance, or a bond cover, or a mortgage insurance product that is going to cover you for as long as you have an outstanding amount on the bond. When you settle and you stop paying the bond insurance, that insurance also falls away, because what will it be covering if you have settled the bond? Simple, makes sense, easy to understand, right? So when you settle the bond insurance also falls away. And it's important to remember that you need to cancel the bond insurance the moment you settle your bond. Because a lot of people, what happens is that insurers are not going to come to you and say, oh, by the way, you've settled your bond, so we're just going to stop debiting your account. For instance, I still have a 4 rand that goes off my account. I don't know. I know it's credit insurance, but I don't know what credit it is. Because what I didn't do is that when I settled whatever credit it was, I didn't go back to make sure that I stopped paying the credit insurance. So it's the same thing when it comes to your bond insurance. The moment you settle, you need to cancel it because you no longer have an insurable risk. And that insurable risk basically is paying off the bond or paying the bond while you are unable to pay, right? Now, how does it work with a life insurance? Basically, with a life insurance, it works a similar way. But what is life insurance? Life insurance basically is an insurance over your own life and the financial obligations that you've got in your life, right? Because what you don't want is you dying, right? And then your children get kicked out of the house because the house wasn't settled by the time you died and there's not enough money to be able to settle the house. Your children cannot service the bond repayments and now they're going to get moved out because the bank needs to repossess the house and the house needs to be sold. So that's basically what it is. So life insurance, it does not look specifically only to the bond. It looks to the rest of your life and your other debt that may exist, right? So it's important for you to understand this. But how would it work? So let's say, for instance, I did have life insurance worth 5 million rand. If I had life insurance worth 5 million rand, I would then cede 2.2 million rand to the bond holder or the bond lender or whatever it is. So the bank that has financed me, in this case for me, it's FNB, right? I would cede 2.2 million of my life insurance to FNB for as long as I have an outstanding bond amount there by FNB. Does that make sense? So let's say I do seed 2.2 million rand, right? By the way, if you do seed 2.2 million rand, it means that they minus the 2.2 million rand from your life insurance, which is 5 million, right? You now have only 2.8 million rands worth of life insurance. That's basically what it means for as long as you have an outstanding amount when it comes to your bond. So let's give you a proper example. If, let's say, I do seed 2.2 million rand and I'm still owing 2.2 million rand and I die tomorrow. God forbid. I don't owe 2.2 million rand. I've paid. Yeah, don't stress. I've paid half of my bond already. Come on now. But let's say on the day, 2016, it's October. I've just borrowed 2.2 million rand from the bank. I've ceded 2.2 million rand to my life insurance. And I die. Right? God forbid. But it's in the past. It doesn't matter anymore. I die. What will happen is my life insurance, if it does pay out the full 5 million rand, it will first and foremost go and pay the 2.2 million rand to FNB. Before it even puts that money into to pay in off anything and gives it to my beneficiaries who I've put on the list, it will first pay off that 2.2 million rand and guarantee them the house, right? Then they've got the house. Then the balance of it will then be paid out to my beneficiaries. That's basically how it works. Well, paid off first to settle whatever needs to settle, and then the rest will be paid off. If, let's say, I've paid maybe 2, 3, 4 years, and now I only owe the bank 1 million rand, the 2.2 million again will first go to the bank, pay off that money, the balance, the difference will be paid back into my life insurance policy, and then it will pay to my beneficiaries or settle whatever other debts they are. Now, what are the pros and cons or the advantages and disadvantages? Let's start off with the bond insurance. Because the bond insurance only covers you for the bond and the outstanding amount, it also means that the moment you settle, that money goes away. So you can't go back and say, I've been paying 20 years of bond insurance, can I at least get back some money? No, because it's an insurance. So you paid for you to be covered for when you had an outstanding amount of money. On the other side, a life insurance, the moment you settle, you get back basically your 2.2 million, it will get back and added to the 2.8, and now you've got your full life insurance of 5 million rands worth. I have heard that obviously the life insurance generally is probably cheaper than a bond insurance. A lot of people say this, but you must also remember that you can get a recalculation of the bond insurance that you're paying, because as you are paying, the outstanding amount is becoming less and less, right? So because it's becoming less and less, you should essentially be paying a lower premium than what you would have paid when you first initiated the bond insurance. Whereas with a life insurance policy, life insurance generally increases every single year, right? So there's an increase of it. But for me personally, I feel that it's an opportunity cost I'm willing to pay. Why? Because at the end of the day, all the amount that I have paid additionally, right? Not even additionally, because if you are quoted on 5 million rand life worth of life insurance, it means that you're paying 1,000, let's say you're paying 1,000 rand on 5 million rands worth of life insurance, right? When you see the 2.2 million, there's no additional amount that you're now paying towards a bond insurance. It just means that you've ceded 2.2 million rand off your life insurance. So as it increases every year, I'm okay with it, because when I settle my bond, which I'm planning to settle in 5 years, I just get back that 2.2 million rands worth of life insurance. Whereas if it's a bond, and let's calculate it. Let's say you are paying a bond insurance of, let's say your bond insurance cover is 450, right? 450 multiplied by 240 months, because that's how long 20 years is, 240 months, right? You pay 108 worth of bond insurance, right? Basically, because I'm calculating it from today's amount. But obviously it decreases. Now that's 108,000 rand that you might not be able to get back. So I don't know. I think, and remember that with a bond insurance, there's an additional amount that you're now paying outside of what you're paying for your life insurance. So the question that a lot of people ask is, should I have both? It's up to you. You need to go and speak to your financial advisor. I can't sit here and tell you. But essentially, if you do have enough life insurance to be able to cover your bond, why not cede that amount, right? And or increase your life insurance, get a different premium, and then cede that life insurance to your bond. Or you could get a bond insurance. Then at least you know the house is settled on its own. If something is to happen to you, that's all settled, and you still get the life insurance policy amount that you wanted if something is to happen to you, for instance, if you die. I think the other argument is that some people have a life insurance that is not a comprehensive life insurance. So it doesn't have a disability cover, it doesn't have an income protector, it doesn't have a dread disease cover, so it doesn't have the additional benefits that you would need, or it doesn't cover the additional insurable events. But generally, banks have their own criteria of what type of a life insurance you need to have for it to be used as your bond insurance, or as your insurance over your bond. So if you do have a life insurance that doesn't have a disability cover, doesn't have a retrenchment benefit, doesn't have a dread disease benefit, they will not use that life insurance as the insurance over your bond. They will tell you you need to get an additional life insurance that has those benefits. That's generally how I've understood it, in how the banks will assess also the life insurance that you've got to see if it's suitable for them. Because remember, for them, it's a risk if you are to die and you are still owing them a lot of money on your bond. So they want to make sure that you've got some sort of insurance over that bond, so that if something is to happen to you, then there is somebody that actually can pay. A question that we got from somebody when we started having this discussion was, is there something that will pay for me while I'm still alive and I'm still, let's say for instance, I cannot afford my bond anymore. Unfortunately, there is no insurance product that's going to pay for you when there is no insurable risk, right? Yes, being unable to afford your bond is a risk, right? But the reality is there is no actual product that's been created for when you are unable to afford, because affordability and losing your salary are two different things, right? And that's how you've got to look at it. Yes, an income protector can kick in when you lose your salary or your ability to derive an income. Disability cover will kick in if you are disabled and unable to derive an income, right? Retrenchment benefit will kick in if you get retrenched, because again, you are unable to derive an income to service the debt. But if you simply say, I changed jobs and now I'm earning a lower salary, or I've overcommitted myself with other debts and I can no longer afford my bond, there is no actual product I don't know of that is an insurance product, and I stand to be corrected, and I'd love anybody who knows a product like that that can kick in to pay for those things. Because if you're unable to afford, what you need to then look at is refinancing the property and potentially getting a lower installment so that you can now afford the house, or you need to rent it out and let the house make you money so the house can pay for itself. That's basically what you've got to look at. So I do hope that I've answered your questions. If you've got any more questions, please drop them in the comment section. We're going to have a Nicolette Save My Finances every single week where I answer some of your questions outside of financial advice and more on financial education, because it's important for me to educate you on how the products work so that you can make the right advice for yourself and make the right decisions.